Yes, hello. Hi, another talk. this time it's I'm Cara, this is Paul and Anthony, and we're all part of this publishing project called Cesura Acceso. This is the website on the back screen here. I'm just going to do a short reading and then we will progress on to a little bit more of a discussion. Apologies for reading from my phone. So this is an extract from the editorial from issue one, which came out, when did it come out? 2014. Yeah. Okay. Cesura Acceso. We pronounce it Cesura Acceso or Cesura Acceso. Is that right? You need to see that for it to work. Is a publishing project. The project positions itself at the intersections of music, experimental politics, and poetics. We want to ask what it could mean to practice politics through music, or to think music through politics. The project was started by Paul Abbott and Gabriel Humberstone, Gabriel's not here, in 2013. The editorial collective now includes Cara Tolmie, Christina Chalmers, Anthony Isles, and Lauren Abbs-Gogherty. We published the first issue of our journal in 2014, and issue two is due out in January 2017, so we're just getting that together now. We also recently published a pamphlet of Howard Slater's essay, A Blind Eye Turned, notes published, notes on music and libidinal economy. And there's actually copies in the back that you can help yourself to. And we've also previously published a fold-out pamphlet of Josephine, a short story by Franz Kafka. And we have facilitated a number of live events as well, which includes music, live music, discussion, performance, poetry readings, and DJing and dancing. Yep, important. It is our attempt through the project to contribute a tool and provocation against capital towards energizing discourse, cultivating alliances, confusing taxonomies, hardening resistances, antagonizing forms, and finding the outer spaceways. For us, music can be understood not simply as sound phenomena organized in time and exchanged for cash within the factory of post-industrial capitalism, but also, amongst other things, as an aesthetic, poetic, political mode of inquiry, a mode of perception, and a way of learning and sharing. Music is also about and of bodies. Experiments in politics, language, and music are interconnected within spheres of survival, struggle, and desire. Cesura Acceso probes how these entangled human social material practices deal with the tensions between trying to live more of a life and trying to combat the impressions that militate to limit any living. This journal explores, through music, politics, and language, the means we have, in spite of our limitations, to be part of an ecology of resistance and learning that includes skin, organs, ideas, imagination, flight, asylum, and history. Somebody else's idea of somebody else's world is not my idea of things as they are. Somebody else's idea of things to come need not be the only way to vision the future. What seems to be need not be what need had to be. For what was is only because of an adopted source of things, some chosen source as was. Need not be the only pattern to build a world on. And that's from what we just listened to, which is Sunra's, somebody else's idea. So that's just to give you a bit of an idea of where we're coming from. But perhaps it's good to go back a little bit and explain a little bit more about what the publication is and where it came from and why it was begun.
Yeah, I mean, maybe also just to say that editorial was written by me and Gabriel, and the writing of the editorial was a way of also working out by inscribing, learning about what we were doing, is one thing, a bit like the project in general, following an impulse, what seemed like, what felt like something urgent, getting together as a couple of friends who have no experience of writing and writing about these things in particular, and working out how to do that. It's also written in 2013-14. It feels like it's obviously could do with some improvement or revision or things change, and the project has gone through various things.
I kind of joined Cesura a bit later after the kind of Paul and Gabriel had established things and kind of established a sort of editorial kind of line of interest. But I think what interested me, I kind of was aware of it as soon as it started in Paul and Gabriel as musicians and people kind of around in different, or meet in different situations. And I think it was really exciting for me to see a kind of project about music, writing, thinking about writing about and publishing around music started by musicians and with a very kind of explicitly, well, opening to the political rather than a kind of definite or explicit political line.
Yeah. I suppose that's something to say is that, me and Gabriel met through music and spent a lot of time at gigs as well as in various demonstrations and reading groups and meetings, so variously around political and music aesthetic worlds in London, also important to say, I suppose. It's also important to say that Howard has been massively influential and generous and helpful in the beginning of the project and continues to be. So even though his name's not down as officially a member of the editorial team, it's like he's in the orbit continuously of what we do. It's really important. And without Howard, we wouldn't have had a place to work on the project, for example. So our backgrounds in music. And then really, I was just thinking when we were talking upstairs before about why the project, and actually, or where did it come from, and why, and actually, I think if it was first following an impulse that to best maybe process the environment in which we were in, which was London at a particular point, the space with the most potential for us was somewhere in between music, political, theoretical, discursive environments, art practices, maybe. And a need to somehow, writing through that, I suppose. Writing is a way of learning and surfacing what it was that we knew about these things. What else is important to say?
I think...
Some practical things about the different, the means of production, like how the first issue was made, and the difference between the way the first issue was made and now how we're working on the second issue.
Yeah.
So I can't say that much about the first issues.
I mean, the first issue was me and Gabriel selected the material in the issue. So it's a variety of different kinds of material, from contemporary writing to historical material found in archives, unpublished material, reprinted material. But we chose what that was and organised it. The second issue, we decided it was...
And you were self-funded at that point.
We had no money from anywhere to do what we were doing. So obviously we're not paid for our time, and relied on the generosity of the people that were alive that we could contact whose material would be published to donate that freely. or on the promise that if and when we might ever have some money, that we could retrospectively pay for that.
Also, you did a gig kind of party as a fundraiser, which was kind of interesting. And to me, at least, it's just deployed music as a way of getting resources to to publish about it in some sense.
And then the second issue, which will be printed in January, this coming January, we put out an open call for submissions. So most of the material, I think we have five pieces of work which are solicited. So we've contacted specific people to see if they wanted to do something particular.
But apart from our work as well as
and some of our work. But otherwise, it's from an open call. And that felt like an important thing to do, to open up a different kind of space, represent a different world of material.
I think a lot about, in kind of terms of framing Caesura, maybe also a question that I asked about Chris's book and its republication was kind of what's around, like what's around and what's not around in terms of music publishing. And I think there's a sort of feeling in London that if something's a magazine about music, it generally fits a kind of form which involves profiling of musicians, kind of often sort of photography being a strong component of that, kind of charts, suggested kind of listening reviews, and these are sort of not things that Caesura does, or kind of pretty much kind of rarely, or so it's a sort of whole, and I'd say that in a way, like everything in terms of music publishing, well, not everything, sort of certain mainstream of music publishing which stretches from kind of smash hits to The Wire kind of all fits that model. And it's just not, just doesn't seem relevant to...
And most of it's not written by musicians.
No, yeah.
Which is an important distinction.
Yeah.
Maybe could just explain briefly about the editorial collective.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. Or that's kind of when, after the first issue, you got some Arts Council funding, at which point Gabriel and Paul invited a number of us to come and be part of an editorial collective, which me and Anthony are both involved in. And maybe that's a kind of important turning or difference between issue one and issue two, in that issue two was put together by a group of six of us.
Mm-hmm.
And we're all coming from quite different backgrounds in a way. And we have a lot in common, but it's a mixture of people who have experience with... in academia, artists, poets, musicians. So I think it'll be interesting to see if that will create a palpable difference in issue two.
Yeah.
I don't know if it will.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose just to briefly mention that also has required us to try and be generous but negotiate the various awkward ways in which we cohabit that process and have differences of opinion and histories. And, there's probably lots of like small bits of the project which we could spend some time on or too much time on, but we felt it was it would be really interesting to us at least to hear some of what other people had to say related to some of the kind of core issues of what the journal for us is about, the relationship between music and politics and publishing, basically poetry, language.
And maybe it's a good time to go back to some of the questions that were coming up yesterday about the types of writing that exist about music and how people here feel about that. And because, of course, we could go deep into how we feel about it, but that's from a context of London. That's our experience in the UK. So we thought it would be a nice opportunity to open that up to people here, because there has actually been quite a lot of talk about... writing about music and maybe academia and things like that. So it would be nice to hear what other people had to say about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've got some specific questions to ask, but if anyone has also any questions to ask, either about the project, but maybe about this situation that we find ourselves in and the festival and how these things join up or don't join up, then now's the chance to ask them, talk about that stuff.
Yeah.
The festival was titled as being about music and politics, but we haven't maybe spoken so overtly about that up until now. And yeah, it would be nice to open that up.
Yeah.
I wonder how you see the position of the journal and your publishing activities in the context of the publishing industry as such. What's the relationship, and how do you figure out the conundrums that obviously the publishing industry imposes on such projects?
I could say something about that. In a sense, it relates less to a industrial logic, or in some ways, I mean, I think you could put a sort of relation there to the kind of tape scene that was talked about earlier in the festival. But there's a kind of strong influence of self-publishing, DIY projects, the kind of means of production. Apart from kind of ourselves and our kind of our sort of own kind of writing and kind of communication skills, is a sort of desktop computer and the ability to have email lists and to make, you know, to have publishing software relatively low costs for kind of print publishing, ability to kind of contact people internationally through kind of email or Skype or other resources. So, and I think maybe also a component of that as well is probably, I don't know if people in the region know the blog Monoscope, but it's like a kind of it's run by someone from a region, and it's a website where a lot of material about experimental media, arts, and sound. It's kind of like a sort of archive and repository, and they actually, without us kind of knowing, sort of scanned the whole issue of Caesura and made it available. So there's a PDF there, and I'd imagine there'll be further PDFs there available, of course.
And you can get the PDF on our website as well.
Yeah, you can download everything for free.
Sure. Yeah. Sorry, people.
Because I feel I need to add something. Far from criticizing the idea as such, on the contrary, I'm supportive of such projects, but I just wonder how to, not just this one, but generally speaking, how to imagine the position of such projects in the context of somehow to avoid perhaps potentially the proliferation of certain patterns and paradigms, and to avoid the replication of certain modes of communication in a very broad sense.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like, another difference, crucial difference with that industrial model is there's no advertising. We don't solicit records and promote individual artists, you know.
Yeah.
There's not that kind of reciprocal relationship. There is a relationship to kind of working musicians and artists, but not a kind of relationship to necessary big label, you know, labels, small or big, or I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, maybe it's
interesting.
It's completely naive, but I don't feel the effects of the pressures of the publishing industry on what we do to a degree to which we feel conditioned by it. Like, I feel like what we have been doing is out.
You didn't.
I don't at the moment.
Right.
Yeah, like, okay. I mean, probably what is actually naive, but that's the way I like it.
But it's not that Caesura is not a kind of commodity, but it has a small life as a commodity. Through more or less the auspices of our distributor. So we have a very good small independent distributor who sends the journal around kind of Europe, and small bookshops and music shops and so on. So that's it does, and it's, that's quite important to me, because I feel, well, personally, I've had an experience where I kind of was involved in publishing a book and we couldn't sell it. It wasn't possible for the institution to sell the book, so we had to basically arrange a system whereby it would be swapped. People could kind of trade for it. But that annoyed me because I knew most people would look for book in shops. People find cultural objects through shopping, and that wasn't kind of possible with this book. So I think it's kind of, but it's not its overwhelming sort of definition, nor is its kind of relationship to the promotion of other musical commodities. I think that's a, which is already makes it so different from so many other music publishing initiatives. I think that's, which is a strange.
Yeah. Hopefully that answers a bit.
So, yeah, I wanted to ask just for people in the room, kind of what do they think music writing is for? Like either about music or even themselves writing about music. I'd be quite curious to hear how people think about. Very general.
Okay. So, first of all, in Serbia, there is a huge gap between this just plain music journalism and a like serious, like I don't know, academic sort of writing about it. And basically, all thing you asked us here doesn't really exist in Serbia. But something else exists in Serbia. This is, I hope I won't monopolize the dialogue here, but there is a different, more still sociological sort of a front that is open, and this is still about the issue of basically Turbovolk and diesel sort of subculture or mainstream culture, which was, you know, as you probably know, proliferating here in the 1990s. And this sort of diesel subculture would have its most adequate parallel in the UK sphere with the so-called chav, you know, subculture. Did I pronounce this right? Chav?
Chav. Chav.
Chav.
Chav.
Chav. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So diesels are sort of chavs.
Right.
So basically you have a front that has opened in recent years, mostly on internet blogs, which basically try to recuperate this idea of turbofolk and diesel subculture in the 1990s, which was ostracized as a sort of a basically popular support, ground support for the regime of Slobodan Milošević. And there are a couple of blogs like Diesel Gorivo, and like Teoria from Teretane, theories that have done it, which have opened theory from the gym blog, which have opened up this field to basically reevaluate the common idea of this sort of subculture as a basically true, proper, working class kind of culture, which was oppressed by this sort of civic elitism of the opposition, which rallied pretty unisonly around rock and roll or alternative music culture as this bastion of like civic values and basically good taste. So we don't have anything like anything of this sort you're talking about, but this there are fronts that are opened up on like these sort of music blogs which generate trends that at least for me are very interesting and that might give a that might basically that open up interesting new fields of fight.
What do you want from writing about music, or what do you like? What kinds of writing about music do you find useful?
Like writing in general.
Writing about music, or well, around music, or through music.
If you ask me,
yeah,
okay. I don't know. I don't. I'm probably bad. I'm probably a bad example because I have a really like super marginal position, and I don't know how what we could universalize for my answer. I'm really afraid.
I don't know if we need to universalize. I'm just interested.
Fine, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's fine to speak from a personal, but you don't have to answer it either if you don't have anything or don't have.
I don't know. I don't have anything. I would go for this.
I mean, I'd also like to know if there's any of the musicians that have been participating in the festival that have an opinion on that. So one simple question would be the meaning, the effect, the desires around the republishing of Chris's book. I mean, maybe easiest for you two to talk about because you're part of that process, but also anybody else. I mean, to me, the Caesura project comes out of an instinct that that it's a place in which some issues might be able to be resolved, quite simply. Like related to, for me, of course, because most of my time is spent around and with music making, and then trying to find ways to understand it better and to create a kind of critical discourse from that, I suppose. But if there was a similar impulse which you have, maybe that was totally unclear thing to say. Should I? Might. Yeah, I just now I'm here. Yeah. Yeah, just quite simply, if there's any of the musicians that have participated for which publishing is something either that you feel is absent. So publishing in the sense of that you yourself write and share written material, or if there's already publications in existence which provide, which help you to understand what you do, or make it more difficult to understand what you do, and challenge that might mean that you can make connections between political thoughts and potentially activities. And also that this festival is perhaps a center of gravity for some of those things. I mean, maybe either of you two could comment.
I think I can make a comment on that, and this is clearly my point of view, so my personal point of view. One of the reasons this festival was made was actually to wake up the idea that this is necessary.
Mm.
So my question for you at the end of what I'm saying would be, what was the primary impulse to start this thing in 2013? So in a way you have responded, but on the other hand, here the situation is that me personally, I think about these things, I don't write, because I don't know that there is anybody I could share it with.
Mm.
So in a way, meeting you guys here now, maybe I could write a paragraph and send it to you, rather than post it in Serbian somewhere on like Facebook or my blog or whatever.
Yeah.
So I believe the issue is that there is no idea about even starting to write, or why would I write it.
Mm.
Maybe I think it, maybe I have a need, as Chris said, to understand things, to get the ground, on the ground. I have this need. But if I write it, I will just keep it for myself. There is no one to read it, to be interested in.
Yeah.
I want to communicate it with except myself.
Mm.
So, as a mean of putting your thoughts on paper, fine. But as a mean of making a publication or whatever, my personal opinion is that republishing Chris's book and this festival is about waking up the need in the music community. And one of the reasons we talk about organization, this festival in March, an event in March, is exactly this.
Yeah.
Come on, guys, organize, think about things. You think about things, write them, communicate them. Try to make a collective of some sort, political, musical, whatever, aesthetical. It doesn't have to be connected with politics. It's just about communication, about things you do with your art, whatever it is. So, I'm finishing this talk, I mean my talk, and I'm and with the question, what was the primary impulse? You said, okay, now we're going to make this, we're going to make a gig and get the money to make this book. But why did you do it?
I think, just as I said before, I mean, so to speak kind of on behalf of Gabriel, and I can speak for myself. So we spent our time playing music around music performances, around political theory and discussions, and all sorts of the activities that went on in London before 2013, and then somehow just following an impulse. We're friends, so we just spent a lot of time together. At some point during that time, we just said, why don't we attempt to do this thing? And maybe it's, it's sort of, it would be easier to make it, to give you a kind of easy narrative in retrospect, and put to the side the fact that it was this weird, contingent, emergent, spontaneous thing that just came out of like scratching your head and feeling like something's missing, and oh, we do this stuff, we play all the time, and we take it really seriously and go to these gigs, and we'll stand outside and talk for hours about it, and then we'll go to this discussion about, you know, the state of housing or radical feminism or God knows what. I wonder if that, what would happen if we tried to somehow make a container to combine some of these different ideas, and if the people that participate in some of those ways of learning things and talking and thinking, if it all started to connect, you know. I mean, also there's the mean, hearing you talking about writing and thinking, just and publishing, just to socialize some of the thinking that's done, you know, to work against the sort of privatization of some of these processes. So we might busy away in even in a kind of collective improvisation context, which could be described in some ways as sharing, communal, collective, there's various ways. Actually, it can be extremely lonely. There's surplus things which you feel in those experiences to me, which it's not to diminish anyone that doesn't publish or write essays about their experiences, because their entire human experience is in those moments. But if there's a sort of surplus that you might feel, what to do with that, and maybe to put that to use in this kind of way might be beneficial. You know, it might be socially useful. It might be politically productive. It might do something. You know, to kind of catalyze acting. So it was an impulse. It was a. Make it seem more sensical retrospectively, but I think it became, to me, it felt like one of the spaces which was available to me, which was maybe more free of some of the, I don't know how to best describe this. So I used to make videos, as well as music and various other things, I felt like there's the various practices and worlds in which you can inhabit. Many of them were shut down really quickly with professionalization and financialization, and you know, these things which can, to me, they just felt unhealthy. They just shut down too much. And of course, this is my totally subjective, personal set of feelings about a space in which something more generous and productive is possible. But this was that space for me. A relationship between music and then trying to write about it. It was simple as that. And just following that impulse, and then trying to do it, and then suddenly you're just doing it, and you think, well, I've got to finish it now. And then you try and find some money to do it, and then to be able to share it, and then strangely loads of people were really excited about it, and it made us think, oh, maybe that impulse touched something, you know. Does that make sense? Is that useful? Yeah.
I think there's a sense from kind of both what you say there is that there's kind of a publishing is kind of community, you know, can be community building. I mean, it can be, you know, both in the sense that, yeah, it kind of, it forces you to be in touch with others. I think you dealt with this quite nicely in terms of the, because when I say publishing, I also mean like someone who's just like scanning a tape cover and uploading it. Like that's a kind of, it's a form of publishing. Think of, you know, relate the field of publishing around Caesura to like everything from sort of people uploading stuff to YouTube to kind of to zines to sort of web blogs, or even just like music discussion, you know, mailing lists. These things are, in a sense, kind of publishing, sharing thoughts about music, having exchanges, and they kind of build kind of communities of thought and kind of, in a way, feedback into practice. So it's also like that's a sort of vast subterranean field that doesn't really have a lot to do with the sort of smash hits kind of wire continuum. And I think so that's kind of, and I think in a way that I definitely think when I think about Caesura, it's like, well, a lot of what I read about music is online now and PDFs and things like that, both historical and contemporary material. But I sort of think, okay, well, Caesura has to sort of relate to this world that is somewhere, not the academic world, but somewhere more, you know, both between, you know, it's got to be, I don't know, a bit more rigorous than a blog, you know, or, you know, if I'm thinking what kind of essay would be good to publish or try and attract. So,
yeah.
But there's also, I think that the sense with the kind of, well, the kind of community you build out of editors, but also the vast amount of like contributors you're going to be in touch with, and how that's going to open you to new avenues of inquiry and thought and knowledge of new practices is really worthwhile. You know, you could start that on quite a small scale, just by running a blog. You could start to get in touch with people.
Yeah, I was also just thinking then about poetry as well, and mine and Gabriel's exposure to poetry communities, of which Danny part of a mirror, and that there was, I mean, for me, like, just to talk for myself again, like there's some desire or need to go to like extra musical material or places, like stuff else, so I couldn't find things that helped me to understand or rigorously kind of critique my music practice or other music maybe at that time, and so somehow to go at a tangent away from this and contingently to suddenly be exposed to an active energetic visible poetry communities in that material as well as other things, but just to use that as an example was really helpful, you know. And then just to realise that just that, quite simply, you know, somehow in the absence of those descriptions, you kind of, you seem to feel like you go way off into some other place, and actually it helps in complex ways. You're able to reflect back on your discipline maybe, or your practice, the specifics of that, in an unorthodox way maybe, or whatever it might be. And maybe also actually in the, what feels like a massively apolitical musical environment, that the poetry community was so explicitly political, intelligent and confident with the material, but you know, as another aesthetic practice, it was energizing, you know. Yeah.
I have one more question. You stated a couple of forums that you can do publishing, like a blog, YouTube, uploading a picture, cover, something. Do you think that having a hard copy of a book makes a difference in today's world? I mean, having a physical object with, like, writing inside, does it make a difference? Does it? I mean, why did you decide to get money to print if there is a possibility to have it online?
Why? Why?
Yeah, I'm just, yeah, but
why did you put that through? I just want
to hear like an answer.
For me, it's like, makes sense in that you're going to make it. You're trying to make a specific object. You know, you're trying to, you know, kind of angle it from something really specific. No, but and it make it, you know, has a very different life in the world. You know, it than, you know, just like a erratic collection of things on the blog, or you know, or some, you know, something else. So there's a kind of sort of argument for a certain seriousness for taking music and taking politics of music seriously, that is communicated by, like,
yeah, I think
reasonably heavy object.
Also, I mean, for me also it can, am I really quiet? Really? It just feels like it's going to feedback. Okay. Sorry. I can give it to you like that, you know, and we can talk about it. That's one exciting thing, you know, person to person. It's also just to celebrate the material somehow. I get excited by how this paper feels, you know, and the colour of the thing and typesetting it and all these. Yeah, you know, that stuff's important to me. And I don't think it takes it into a politically problematic or conservative territory necessarily. You know, I think it's like something to kind of retain or reclaim or whatever. It's the possibility to celebrate something. You know, I mean, I feel like you're probably talk a lot more about things and the various issues of distribution and commodity. But that's enough for me to answer that question. Yeah.
So I've been running a small studio in Melbourne, Australia for about 13 years, mainly for myself, basically improvising with a collective once a week for over a decade now. And we've kind of been recording every week for that time, and I've been slowly trying to cut together pieces of music and trying to get that out, you know, into albums. And after 10 years, I started sort of thinking about, you know, I'm still doing this, still enjoying it, but I want something else, you know. And so therefore decided to, I guess, leave Melbourne and go travelling, and by chance came across this festival and landed here. And it's just nice to have this, basically have words to not justify my actions over my last 12 years, but it's just from, you know, my instinctive kind of just wanting to play music without any musical training, and having a collective, a group that was also up for doing that, even though it's changed members over the years. I don't know, I just feel like having something written, something to read and think about, has kind of inspired me to keep going with that and to go back and maybe start doing more research, and starting to find new avenues with my music. So I don't know, is that something you think about when you're writing about music, like trying to, I guess, inspire other people to think about music in a literary sense, you know? And I guess my only interaction with that world has been through the beats, you know, and my fascination with the cut-up kind of technique, and that's why I really enjoyed Paul's talk a couple of nights ago on using the studio as an instrument. You know, it's been a very big thing for me for a very long time. Just wondering how you feel about that in general, you know.
I suppose the simple answer is yes. You do, yeah, you know, you hope that. I mean, my experience is probably similar to yours, and not trained musician, and just had the desire to work, to make music, and just get on with it, and then, you know. So this is also a kind of a vehicle to help outside of happening to be in an institution, and not that I necessarily have that I would. The institutions are all negative for me or anything, but just don't happen to be in there. That it's a way to learn, you know, inspire myself and inspire other people. Not necessarily to think in any particular way about music, but just to think about music, you know, or just to be able to think in another place. I mean, there's a thinking about music that you'll know as someone that does it, that you do when you're making it, you know, but to have another space available for a different kind of thinking. And those different ways in which that can be socialized, it's been really significant and important, and I hope that it is for other people as well, you know.
I just wanted to say something about what I have learned through proximity to the people that are in this group, and also more to you. And I think before I knew you very well, I'd spent a lot of time going to music which wasn't, whatever you want to call it, popular music, or I don't know, lots of different forms of music which are maybe more improvised or however you want to call it, but not spending very much time realizing the thought, a lot of the thinking, and also the politics that go on behind that music. And it was only really through proximity to you and other people that you like, Seymour, people like that, people that you play with, and that kind of community, to realize the depth of thinking that was going on, and also how that thinking related to, yeah, like political ideas, political impulses, poetics, articulation, just different forms of articulation. And I think although I'd spent a lot of time with that music, I really hadn't any idea about the discussion and the thinking that was going on behind it. So for me, when Suzura started up, what was really exciting to me about that was about self-representing all that stuff that was going on behind the scenes that you wouldn't necessarily get access to otherwise. You know, like, it's, you could go along to these concerts, these gigs, and you could probably guess something about the organisation of them, or the kind of, you know, the kind of conversations that would have been going on at, like, the workshop, like a, you know, and if you're improvising with people every week for 10 years, you're going to talk about stuff. But that is, I think it's not so well represented yet. And that for me was an exciting possibility within this project, was as someone who might not be right inside of those discussions to have access to them, because it's really useful to understand that music and articulate things and inscribe things that you probably knew were there, but I think it's just really important that they are self-represented and that there's control taken over the language with which those things can be represented and the range of languages with which those ideas can be represented. And I hope that this journal is an open container where we can continue to represent a range of these languages and learn all the different ways that people might be able to articulate those processes for themselves. And I think we're all really interested in those articulations being new for us too, and weird and complicated and difficult and challenging, and not homogenized. So yeah, that's important to me.
Yeah, I kind of wanted to open up that to the room, because I'm programmed to do a talk in an hour or something, 2 hours, like one in the morning.
4 hours.
But I'm not going to do the talk because I didn't prepare it. So instead, within this kind of space, we discuss kind of opening up to like more informal discussion or discussion from kind of everybody else, in terms of, I guess, how you know, my question, simple question, how do people reflect on the, you know, the series of kind of gigs and concerts that have taken place within this setting? You know, so, you know, is it, I mean, we kind of raised the idea of writing, but that might not be the only form of reflection about improvisation. There might be actually much more appropriate forms to reflect on improvisation, like humming or
shouting,
screaming in the shower. So yeah, I just wanted to kind of throw that out there.
Yeah, can I also just add to that, and then we're quiet. But just what politics means to different people in relation to music, in relation to this context, like for each of us, or for anyone that wants to, that has a feeling for it, and wants to share that. Yeah, what it means. Because I think it might be different for different people.
The meaning of politics.
Yeah. Yeah. It, yeah. And in this context as well.
I think for me, just, it's been, I work in a very archaic form. The tradition with, in which I work, documentary making. And it's been an absolute revelation, because I can communicate, I can sort of transfer some of the breakthroughs you're making in form. I found Chris's talk very fascinating, hearing you getting together and come form a collective around these writings, creating communities, is a very, very exciting thing to hear. So my way of looking at it would be, I can literally make shifts in the visual medium that I'm using as a result of hearing some of the breakthroughs, the playfulness, the bravery, that I'm seeing here. So I just wanted to sort of share that, because I'm very kind of have always felt slightly intimidated by music as a form, because what you don't know, you feel like you can't access. But it's been very interesting having that sort of cross communication.
One thing I can say is that this event for me is a continuation of the workshop Chris held here in March, which was quite inspiring, and I believe that that event was a continuation of certain talks I had years and years before with some people that came in contact with Chris and Dickmeyer and other people. My point being that I don't see this in from my perspective as a musician. I see this event as a continuation of something that is necessary for me. Because I believe that communicating ideas, not strictly in a political sense, like society or like questions of Marxism or philosophy, whatever Ali Dan says, but maybe communicating ideas about emotions, about everyday life, is something that boosts creativity. And in my practices, I have I see it as different results if you really talk about things first, like really talk them through, and then do exactly the same thing, but I have a feeling it's better after the conversation. Like if we play the same thing one time, and then we talk about it for 7 days and play it again the same way, somehow you feel differently, and if you record it, it sounds different. And this is purely a result not from practicing your instrument, or but just by thinking and communicating. So in that sense, events like this and approach which has like philosophical background or emotional background or some sort of background that you can communicate through language or writing is a necessity. It's very important to be there. So this is, yeah, thank you.
When you already mentioned the intention to talk about the magazine, it's basically why we actually already argued yesterday, and it's important to republish the book. It's something that it comes to us very important in several levels. We could actually follow the separate tracks of reasonable, you know, facts for us. And first of all, I think then it's something which producing us as a absolute beginners on a field of liberal trade and market, which traced the whole society in Serbia. And we think then it's important that artists start to think and openly express this. Otherwise, then they actually keep this traditional form, then someone will interpret them. And this is immediately, you know, a close and very narrow, you know, track. Then we find very importantly, then people has to really express themselves. Of course, then this is not easy. I mean, specifically when we already talk about this, then we are coming from very traditional ex-cathedra educational system, and it's not, you know, in a nature then people could express themselves and to be ready to really be encouraged to express some thoughts or to dilemmas, and it's not easy in such an environment. And even this then this patience is more than needs, you know. So that's something that we actually find it out interesting for me as well, then to just express this, what has come back as a feedback to you, and how it's support your further steps, you know, in instead of that, how you should really fight for your own, you know, at least in terms of political and ideological aspects, because talking back of waiting for interpreters, you know, then you could be in a very dangerous position, you know. Otherwise, then, and your music, your work, actually, in general, I'm not talking anymore just on the music, in general, in arts, then you're waiting for interpreters, you know, who will really repackage the. So you really have to you know, step on, and this is actually the main major, you know, things. I could also present some very bizarre example then in Serbia, what's going on, specifically in Novi Sad and Vojvodina. Then we have, for instance, then for me it's bizarre, then we have really desperate, you know, empty space of, you know, printing stuff, and we could argue with many aspects of economical, you know, crisis, no money, and etc. But then we have a provincial government who is actually producing the culture magazine, and they're actually covering, you know, culture how they could would like to present, and this is something completely weird. I mean, we actually have, you know, the musicians and the scene are not capable to really fight for their own, and we have top to the down, you know. So it's very, very interesting situation. And just because of this, and I just want to trace this, you know, that it's not something that we could motivate some particular group of people, or it's something that we find out and how we are able to really believe in what we are doing, you know, how we could, you know, establish such a space as this one is, and or how we could, you know, go forward. So this patience of to really create the circle of people that can at least trace their own thoughts, are they could change something, or is it really necessary to go in that direction or another? So that was actually the main frame, and what we can find related to this waiting for the interpreters again, and it's actually established this very traditional form of art market, what we already mentioned yesterday. So this is also a very, very tricky, you know, field. And we find it, and we have to change this. How we could change? We could start to talk about this. So that was kind of the basic ground how we actually start.
Now I wonder, I think, Paul, is that correct? Did you say that playing music or writing was learning or something like that? Something was learning? Was it playing music? I liked it. Although, now I can't remember, but I know I liked it when you said that. But in any case, I just wonder if you had... I don't know how to call them, dilemmas that I might have in the context of that situation. Like, for example, you want to connect art and politics, and you start from a very simple need, I guess, to express your ideas and emotions and whatever in the context of that nexus, right? And then on the other hand, you have the perplexity of a different kind. You have that almost intuitive tendency of art to remain autonomous, sort of. And on the other hand, you also have that, how should I say, almost visceral, like, urge of politics to be sort of, to stay independent in a way of other realms, and then you nevertheless have the need to connect them in a certain sense, and there is this tension, at least from the perspective from which I look at it. I don't know if you if I'm making myself clear enough, first of all, or and then if you share the same ideas.
Well, I think. Well, first of all, I'll just speak for myself, because one thing is I think we'll probably have completely different opinions about those things. Is that my personal interest isn't to attempt to connect art and politics, because to understand those, whatever we individually might put in those containers, like the taxonomy is just not interesting. But it's actually just, so maybe just to talk about the journal in relation to those questions, my interest is just to create a space or an environment or a social context in which we can talk about exactly what you just said, and that it doesn't necessarily need resolving into a specific objective answer, but my feelings are that somehow these things have a relationship already, you know, and different ways of describing them through language mean that the product might be different, or the, you know, the thing changes, but first of all, just that we can talk about that, you know, and that we can put that that can be happening as well as having a practice, so in my case, a material practice. I sit at a drum kit and I play the drums, and then I think of those questions and I talk to other people about it, and that this is a space in which that can be shared and socialized. Does that make sense? Is that, yeah.
Wrap up. Are there any comments or questions? Because if not, we'll just stop.
Yeah.
That might be wrong.